Hello everybody. Thanks for attending this session on big data. I will be presenting a case study which was done between the years 2012 and 2013 on how to cope with big data in a small company. Let's take a look at the content. We try to get as far as possible as of time constraints. Probably not all of the points here will be covered. First, I will tell you about the mission, the technology stack we were using for doing that mission, the development process we were choosing, and then I will get more technical. We will go into the cloud with the software system which we were to build, scale in the cloud. Next is we had to get out of the cloud again as of security issues. And then what happens with cloud applications, they are highly distributed. So how to keep track on your systems, your machines, your services, your tenants, that will be covered in chapter 6. And now let's start with the mission. The mission was on optimizing a customer's web shop by learning from the customers surfing the web shop, optimizing the proposals presented to the customer, to the tenant, and finally increase sales, which was hoped to be good for our company and the tenant of the web shop and the customer, who is happy to get the right products proposed. So to take a look in an overview on that, the mission setup was actually, we have the tenants, we've got the web shop, we've got the software system, a team, and the customer. The tenants, they operate the web shop. It's a multi-tenant software, so we have many tenants, not just one. Their web shops are attached to our software system. Our software systems to do analysis of all the requests. Then we have a team developing our software system. Parts of the team were here located in Novi Sad, and other parts are located or were located in Munich. And finally, we've got the customer whose journey on the web shop is to be recorded for processing, for calculating product proposals and so on. The whole mission was to do individual proposals for customers. So when one customer is highly interested in sports articles on the web shop, then he is likely to get sports articles recommended or articles which comply with bots articles. Well, there were some constraints with the mission. So we had a moving targets mission. The software system we were to develop was to follow an old system and be the new business model for the company. And the mission was not so clear at that moment. So it was moving as new insights were available on the tenants. The market was not well known for us. It was a startup-alike company, so there were time and money constraints, time to market. The software should have been there yesterday already and was still to be set up. We had the split-up team in Novi Sad and in Munich, which meant more communication. Though we had excellent Java skills and excellent architectural skills, so that was the bonus for us, but little cloud and big data experience. We were deciding to use a Scrum-inspired agile process. It's inspired by Scrum. We did not have any Scrum master, as we see from the time and money constraints. There was no space for a dedicated Scrum Master. Okay, I will hurry through the technology stack which we decided to use. Okay, as we had excellent Java skills, we decided to use the Java ecosystem, Java programming language. Time constraints wouldn't allow us to set up another environment and teach all the participants, the developers. We use a Tomcat open source container for connecting the tenants' webshops, for receiving the tenants' webshops data. We use Spring for gluing together the whole application. That's all standard technologies. MySQL we used for data which required referential integrity. No high volume data, just the data for managing our cloud systems. And Maven, also a very common tool for building our application and managing the dependencies of the libraries used for the application. We also used other services, not the standard environment which you can install on the desktop. We made extensive use of PaaS software, Platform as a Service, which is some cloud-hosted high-level API for doing database operations or launching virtual machines for your software. So we used S3, simple storage service from Amazon. Mainly we used Amazon Cloud Services. S3 is a simple storage for flat files. We used SimpleDB, which is a NoSQL database, which organizes its data in so-called domains. One domain can be seen as a single table if you look at a relational database system. Then we used Amazon's RDS, Relational Database Service. It makes us easy for us to manage the databases without operating our own servers. And as of the small team, it's very convenient to have this operated already. And then we've got the EC2, the Elastic Compute Cloud machines. Actually, these are machines you can launch in the Amazon Cloud as you need them. Different operation systems can be chosen to run on that. We were choosing Linux, and on the EC2 instances, we were actually running our Tomcats. We'll take a look at the construction of the software on the EC2s later on. And on top, for load balancing, we also used an Amazon Cloud service, the Elastic Load Balancing, which is provided by Amazon and does the load balancing for us. It's configurable, so it was very neat for us to use the technology stack provided by Amazon. Now here, this image illustrates the setup of the PaaS service, of the platform as a service. On top, we have got the load balancer. The load balancer dispatches incoming requests. Every click on a tenant's web shop results in a request being sent to our systems for recording the customer's journey. And the load balancers dispatch the incoming requests to several machines. Here I just illustrated four machines. So here we already see that we go horizontally. Then we use SimpleDB instances, NoSQL instances, to push the data for further analysis into some persistent store. And here we see we have 8 of those instances. So again, we go horizontally. And then we see the MySQL instances. We don't need many of them because they are just for internal management of our cloud services. So there is no high volume expected on those. I will hurry through the development process, not that exciting. Most of you are familiar with the tools and the processes Here we decided, as of the startup-alike company, to use a SaaS toolset, software as a service, some service hosted out there in the internet. We used Assembler, which is similar to GitHub or Bitbucket. It provides a task management tool for coordinating our distributed team, Git version control for software code versioning. It provides workflows to track our development state, and it also provides user management and time tracking, especially interesting when you have got external developers who have to write bills. Well, as I said before, it's an agile-alike process which we used. I will skip over those. I think most of you know Scrum. The test-driven approach, which we decided to use, was gray box testing. There are a couple of definitions of gray box testing. Is anyone familiar here with the term gray box testing? Actually, there are those styles, black box testing and white box testing. With white box testing, you write unit tests. The developer writes unit tests for his own code after the code was written. Black box testing is different. A different person codes the tests, the unit tests for the developers, for the developed code. So it's different persons, and no problems can arise that internal knowledge of the system being developed influences the tests you are writing. Gray box testing is in the middle. It actually says that a developer is to write the component tests before the same developer writes the code. As of our team size, we did not have the possibility to have a dedicated test person on board, so we decided to use the gray box approach, and that worked very good for us. So even though the same person wrote the tests, who wrote the code, writing the test beforehand actually made the developer think about the cases which could occur and could cause problems before the code actually was written. So the code seemed to be better afterwards. So I will flip through those. Okay, now here comes the interesting part. We go into the cloud. As said before, we were to collect lots of data from the tenants' webshops. As it turned out, a medium-sized webshop produced around 8,000 requests per second, which we had to cope with. So somehow we have to scale, we have to eliminate any bottlenecks. Well, I use Max and Moritz, I don't know if you know them, to illustrate the steps we divided the data flow in our software system. Max and Moritz are some two naughty guys who do bad things and then bad things happen to them. Well, we identified that a classical IPO model, which we use, input, process, output. Here we see we get input, that's the lots of HTTP data. Max and Moritz are the HTTP requests. The input gets processed. While the input is processed, we also have, in our use case, to produce immediate results for the customer surfing the web shop. So the customer gets immediate feedback on product proposals while we do further processing later on. Then we've got the output step. As you can see, the data needs room, lots of room. The more data we have, the more room we need for the data. And then we've got the post-processing, which means that other processes will work with that data. For example, data warehouse systems might be fed to get more insights on the customer behavior. So here we've got the post-processing step. And this is more technical view on the whole constellation. On top, we've got the web shops. Web shops produce the input, which is to be received and for which we have to return immediate results, then the data is being processed, it's normalized, it's a sense is created, and the refined data is to be stored in a data store. And then output is generated from the data stores. All is to happen in a way that different tenants do not slow down other tenants when operating on the software system. When the load of one tenant, as of Christmas business, for example, jumps up, the other tenants must not be affected by that. And here we see in detail how the input step will work. I will now show you the input, the process, and the output steps. To begin with, we use the input step. Here you see an illustration of the component receiving all the HTTP requests. This component can be operated in parallel on many EC2 instances from Amazon, and we use the front controller pattern. Front controller pattern is quite simple. It just says you've got a single point of entry for all your incoming HTTP requests. And inside the front controller, we used interceptors. The interceptors, that's also a pattern which can be applied when processing a request and refining a request and chaining all together. We decided to implement three interceptor process steps: the pre-process, process, and post-process. Pre-process and post-process were just aspects to be processed on each request, like the security issues: is the request a valid request? How long is the processing time when we record the times in the post-processing step? And the process step is the actual step doing the work. So here we've got the pre-process, process, post-process steps. Data comes in, data gets processed, data gets outputted. And the red output here is the output back to the customer serving the web shop. And then we've got the overall process step where the data is being stored in the SimpleDB instances. There is the EPO model is some kind of fractal in computer science. Input, process, output, you find it everywhere. Each method or function call has input, has processing steps, produces output. And in this case study, in this use case, we also made lots of use of the composite pattern, which is a fractal of this case study. Composite pattern, most of you know it most probably. It's actually you define one interface and any kind of component can implement that interface. And when you build components which only purpose is to contain other components, then you've got the composite component. So you can set up a hierarchy as you need it. And we use the composite pattern to implement those processing steps, post-process, process, pre-process in the beginning. And completely different constellations could have been possible as well. Why did we use that kind of components in our architecture? As of the moving targets, the incoming requests varied, and the required output also varied. And we were lazy developers, and we didn't want to do everything from scratch again. So we decided, well, let's build a good outside component, the front controller, and make it pluggable. Everything what we don't need, we can deactivate, remove it. Everything what we need in addition, we just plug it in. So we do not get a bad monolithic system with spaghetti-like code. It remains maintainable, even of changes in the business plan. Here we see the composites. They contain atomic interceptors. the atomic interceptors are actually the ones who have the business logic inside, like refining the data or testing if it's a valid request. And here in the process step, I noted, please do it asynchronously. Things which do not return a result, especially when high response times, fast response times are required. The customer serving the web shop, he wants to get a result immediately. The process step will take longer than immediately. It will take, I don't know, depends on the back-end systems. So we decided to do the process step asynchronously by using queues, putting requests into queues, and having separate threads working on those queues in the background, and the request can respond with a response immediately. Interface-based programming, that's a method where you say the interface and not the implementation is the type which I'm working with. And when you use interface-based programming consequently, you can easily change the structure of systems without affecting the business logic. For example, we could change the front controller to have not three processing steps, but we could change it to have just one by just putting all the interceptors into the process step, and the business logic would not be affected by that. We could also use just one interceptor in the front controller. The front controller wouldn't notice if it's talking with the interceptor or with the composite interceptor. Okay, the front controller is the HTTP entry point. The interceptors are the components out of which it is composed. Here is some background information already said. I will skip over it. Now we come to the process step. Still inside the cloud, we've got to do something with the data which was received by the input step, those 8,000 requests per second per tenant, per web shop. And there are to be some patterns to be applied to avoid bottlenecks. So let's take a look. We called that process step log and store, because it's actually logging the refined data. We used so-called partitioned logging, using the composite pattern again here. You see composite pattern, the fractal of this use case. And again, we use atomic components which do the actual work. Let's take a closer look at the input step. All the data reaching the process step is to be stored efficiently in simple DB domains in the cloud. On top, we've got the partitioned logger. Our system is capable of managing many tenants, and the tenants are not to influence each other regarding throughput. So the partitioned logger, which is actually also implementing a basic logger interface which we defined, takes a look at the incoming data, identifies a partitioning criteria, and depending on the partitioning criteria, it passes the incoming data to one of those three composite loggers. Each composite logger is dedicated to one tenant. So the partitioning criteria is actually the tenant's identifier in the request. Oh, I only have 8 hours to talk, so I hurry up. And in the end, we've got atomic loggers, which also act as the partitioned logger, has the same interface implemented, interface-based programming. And the atomic logger, in the end, addresses a single simple DB domain and stores the data in the simple DB domain. Here's actually the step where we do it asynchronously. Storing in simple DB is quite time-consuming. We address simple DB using a REST API, and all those handshaking takes time. So we actually use queues, the Java concurrency framework provides really cool queues for doing atomic queue operations, and inside the queues are the requests to be persisted. A good thing on the queues is when you find out or when you detect that the queue fills up and doesn't shrink again, then you easily could attach a new atomic logger to your composite logger to cope with the higher loads you're now experiencing so that the queues will shrink again. So having this composite pattern applied in combination with those queues, you easily can scale up and scale down, and the business logic on top is not affected. So the parted logger on top, or the input step actually making use of that process step, addressing the process step, the input step doesn't care whether it addresses an atomic logger or a parted logger or a composite logger. And you also can create completely different hierarchies of parted and composite loggers depending on your requirements. You could also have, instead of the composite logger for the tenants, another parted logger, which is another partitioning criteria to sort the data regarding how your business case needs it. So retrieval would be much easier later, as you then know which partition or which atomic logger to address. Here I wrote down as well, I noted, do not forget housekeeping. Big data means big data is produced. In our case, big data is also persisted somewhere. It is in the SimpleDB instances. If you forget housekeeping or if you don't care, sometime your system administrator will come and tell you that costs are exploding and systems are slow and tenants cannot be satisfied anymore with good analysis of the data. So when you handle big data, you should be aware of the life cycle of your data. How long do you need it? When do you move it away? What do you do to get it smaller? You can consolidate the data, you can combine lots of requests to identify one key value for a tenant. For example, you could create an average sum of orders for a tenant instead of keeping all the single orders. That's actually some topic which the data warehouse team was addressing. That's not part of this case study. Okay, once again, interface-based programming. And here we've got the more verbose explanations of what I just said. Well, just one word on the strategies. How do I determine how many SimpleDB domains I require for a tenant? How do I determine how to partition or how to compose the whole logging structure? Well, it's a science in itself. There are many values to be considered. We actually tried out one and did not take a look too much at the values, and we immediately hit a good solution. So it worked out, and we didn't do any further evaluation on how to optimize it. And there was one. Okay. Yes, and now we come to the output. Now we've got all that big data in our SimpleDB instances. Okay, before I start with the output, are there any questions so far? Is everything clear? Then we continue with the tool set. Okay, small company, the business model not so clear yet. Moving targets, we need to get the output in a quite flexible way. We were to feed succeeding processes, but some of them were still manual and some were automatic. So we have to provide something which can be operated by some person and something which can be automatically called by a software system. So if you think in terms of a tool, command line tool could do the work. You've got a command line tool, you specify some arguments like find all, and you specify the from date and get all the entries in our example here from today. Can be operated by a person can be automated. Well, we also need some modular design on that tool set because of the moving targets, as we saw already in the front controller. Requirements might change, and we are lazy developers. We don't want to do all the work again and again, and we don't want to end up with a monolithic structure, which is very hard to maintain. It saves us time when we try to break the functionality up into little bits and pieces. So for the modular design, we decided to use the command pattern. Command pattern is actually a method to define an operation to be executed. You define it now in your software system, and it can be executed at any time. It also can be distributed throughout system borders, that command. The command is actually the encapsulation of a method inside an object. So think of a method which has arguments, an output value, and which is getting executed. The same is done by the command. The method arguments are actually member variables in the command. So you can execute the command at any time when you call a so-called execute method. Well, we decided to use the command pattern to be able to extend the whole tool set, like we see here. Find all, find, delete, export, import can all be represented by a single command. And we needed flexible querying of the data. SimpleDB has an SQL-like querying language, but as our interface-based programming approach, we do not want to pass through the SQL queries from our abstract logging systems throughout all the composite loggers to SimpleDB, just to have some specific implementation being addressed. For example, if we would change to DynamoDB because we might need some kind of quality of service regarding the throughput, probably the SQL statements would not work anymore. So we decided to use some sentential logic querying language. There are some parsers out there which make it very easy to parse such queries, like I want to get all data of people age greater than 25 and less than 50, or with an order amount bigger than 35 euros. That's plain mathematical expression, and that's being translated into the actual querying language for the actual atomic loggers. That's what the atomic logger itself is doing. It gets this abstract query and creates its own special technology-dependent query. So the SimpleDB loggers were capable of querying using those query strings. We ended up with a console application, so we can call it manual, we can execute it manually or automatic. When we take a look inside that application, actually we can jump through. The console application is a setup of commands. You see those commands. The commands are provided with a context. That's the command line arguments. The commands are provided with the context with the logger system, so the commands can actually do operations on the logged data. And the commands have access to the so-called inventory. We might come to the inventory later, depending on the time. That's actually the system we used to manage our cloud services, our software, the tenants, and the machines, and the relationships between all of them. So the overall process step now finishes, and we want to generate the output. And here we've got the command context, and each command is invoked with the context, and as soon as a command feels responsible for the context, it executes it and signals that it executed, so that the succeeding commands do not need to be invoked. So it jumps out of the chain. Makes things easy for us. Actually, we abused the command pattern because we didn't make use of all the funny things a command offers you, like postponed execution of the command, or especially command pattern can be used in desktop applications to implement undo functionality. Your command has all the values it requires to operate in its member variables. It has got the execute method, and then you could, in addition, implement an undo function. Whenever a command is executed, you put it on a stack, and whenever the user wants to undo that operation, you pull the commands in reverse order from the stack and execute their undo functionality. And if everything is well implemented, you end up with a state as before the command's execution. Interesting aspect on the command pattern for us also was we have lots of code in the commands. We can now use that code in other components as well, not necessarily in console application, so it acts more or less like an API for us in the end. Okay, out of the cloud as of security issues. Let's check the time. I think it's about 15 minutes. Perfect. Okay, in Germany, we are a German company, and in Germany, there are privacy protection laws which are different to the laws in other countries. Amazon Cloud is under the control of the American privacy protection law, which is not as strict as the German one. And the tenants' web shops we were attaching, they required the German privacy protection to be applied because they are located in Germany. So somehow we have to secure the personal data we are collecting, because we are doing individual recommendations to the customer surfing the web shop. It's actually a real person for whom we set up a profile, and now we must make sure that the privacy protection law can be applied to our system so that web shop operators are secure regarding that. Okay, I say secure, if you say something is secure, that's already an error in reasoning, because nothing can ever be, in my opinion, said to be secure, as also the hackers evolve their techniques, and security holes are detected all the time for algorithms which were thought to be secure over years. We assumed the cloud to be untrusted. We assumed that anybody can take a look at the data in the cloud, which is not the case, but that's what we assume to be really secure. We still have to store the data in the cloud in a fast and a secure manner. So securing the data shouldn't cost too much calculation time. And we also have to retrieve big data amounts fast and still secure. We wanted to physically separate the systems working with the private data, with the clear private data, and the other systems having only the secured personal data. So we now divide our system in an untrusted cloud and in a trusted data center. And as asymmetric encryption is very cost intensive regarding computing time, and we've got 8,000 requests per second per tenant's web shop doing it with encoding or encrypting the data with an asymmetric approach would take far too much time. We did some tests and was not feasible, so we combined the asymmetric encryption with a symmetric key algorithm that's common in transporting data throughout the internet, and we also made use of this kind of pattern. Let's take a look in detail how it works. The secure data center generates public and private key pairs. It publishes just the public key pair to the untrusted cloud. In case some attacker gets the public key, nothing bad can happen because the attacker can just encrypt data, not decrypt. And the data center gets encrypted ciphers for the symmetric encryption approach from the cloud. The servers are actually encrypted with the public key. And the untrusted cloud generates volatile symmetric servers in memory, not being persisted anywhere. Shutting down the system will make those servers being lost. It generates huge amounts of those servers. For example, all 10 minutes a new server for encrypting the data. The servers are, the data which we store in the cloud is now encrypted with those symmetric servers. That's very fast. And those symmetric servers are now encrypted with the public key and sent to the data store. So when we take a look, an overall look at the process, we see on the right-hand side the data center. In the middle, we've got the network and the cloud on the left-hand side. I will not go through here in too much detail. Most important thing to note is that in the data center, we generate the keys and just transport the public keys through the network. Then on the in the cloud system, we generate the symmetric servers, but we only transport the encrypted symmetric servers. And also, we only transport the encrypted data in the network, through the network. So that means all communication between the untrusted cloud and the data center should be clean regarding security. The only entry point is the data itself, which receives our cloud system from the web shops. But this is being received with HTTPS. We considered it to be a volatile part. We do not persist any of those information. So here we've got an approach on how to produce lots of secure data in the cloud and still be able to securely decode that data without providing any holes in that infrastructure. This has not been challenged seriously, this approach. So I wouldn't say this is really perfectly implemented. As said before, you can never say anything is really 100% secure. So we are lucky. We can go to the herding cats topic. It's a small thing. Cloud computing does not only mean scalability. We've seen before that we scale horizontally. We use the composite patterns, some parted logger addressing some composite shards. But we have got tenants, we've got simple DB domains, and all of this must be managed somehow. Simple DB domains are assigned to tenants, services are assigned to simple DB domains, services run on Elastic Cloud machines in the cloud, and to keep track on all of this, we decided to implement an inventory, which actually keeps track of all of our systems. It manages the tenants. We've got several tenants operating their web shops. They've got special constraints, special loads to be expected. We've got machines, the EC2 machines, on which we run the software for the tenants. On those machines, we run the services, actually processing the tenants' data. And then we've got the services themselves, which actually do the business logic. And we've got to get together all of those three entities to know on which simple DB domain the data of which tenant is to be stored. And there were some other constraints as well, some other machines which are not mentioned here, which had to be managed as well, such as a recommendation engine, also assigned to specific tenants. And all this information is kept in the inventory. For the inventory, we used the repository pattern. It's actually a blackboard where the information is stored and is available for all the participating services. We used a MySQL database because we needed the referential integrity. In case there are referential problems in our database model, We might actually lock the data into the wrong SimpleDB domains, or we've got some orphaned SimpleDB domains not used and not detected not being used. So here we've got a relational database management system, and the repository pattern allows those services on the various machines to asynchronously pull the information they need to operate to do their job in the software system. Just some small entity relationship model on that. It's a very simplified view. We've got the tenants, we've got the services, we've got the machines, and then we've got all kinds of combinations of that. We've got service configuration depending on the tenants. We've got service configuration depending on the machine the service is running on, and then we've got service configuration depending on the tenant, the machine, and the service itself. So on all those three entities. So it becomes quite complex. The model is far more complex than seen here. And here the relational database approach helped us keeping track on all those entities. Okay, now we are done with all those topics. Probably we've got some 3 minutes, 5 minutes for questions. If there are any, so feel free to ask. Or everything was clear. Then I thank you for your kind attention. Thank you very much.